Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome into Lakers Nation Live. I am Trevor Lane, and the Lakers just crushed the Brooklyn Nets. Great to see. Maybe a few nervous moments, a little bit in the third quarter there, but the Lakers cruise wire-to-wire victory over the Nets, and LeBron James, what a game. LeBron James went berserk. 40 points for LeBron. An unreal performance, 9 of 10. That's 90%, people, from three. LeBron James putting on a show in Brooklyn. What a game. We've got plenty to talk about from this one. We've got Gabe Vincent's return. We've got Jackson Hayes not in the mix tonight due to injury. We've got Cam Reddish. His minutes evaporated. What does that tell us about the Gabe Vincent role? Lots of things to talk about on this show. So welcome in, guys. Thanks for joining me. Whether you're coming in from YouTube, from X, from Facebook, let's talk some Lakers basketball. And let's start right here. Like, this is easy, maybe the easiest one we've ever done.
Superstar of the night.
It's LeBron James. It's that easy. LeBron James, superstar of the night. 13 of 17 shooting for the game. 9 of 10 from 3. 5 of 6 at the free throw line. 7 boards. 5 assists for LeBron. Incredible. 40 points in this one. LeBron James, absolutely unstoppable. There were moments, and I talked about this before the game. Talked about this. How could the Nets pose a problem for the Lakers? You looked at the line. The Lakers were a 6.5-point favorite. You go, 6.5? The Nets are not very good. Yeah, but the problem is they can get hot, and they shoot a lot of threes, so they can become a problem for you on any given night. Cam Thomas, he can go berserk. In fact, that was my first note in things the Lakers needed to pay attention to and worry about. It was a random Cam Thomas blow-up game, and that's exactly what happened. Fortunately, it didn't matter because LeBron James was just that good. You look here, I talked about it before the game, Cam Thomas, you didn't want him to get going, and he certainly did. Finished with 30 points himself, 4 of 7 from 3. Looked like he was going to pull them back into the game late, especially in the third quarter. Just kept hitting big shot after big shot after big shot. But every time, there was LeBron right there to respond. Hitting his own threes, 9 of 10 from deep. Again, LeBron James, absolutely absurd in this one. This is one of those games where you've got to look at LeBron and just say, enjoy it. Enjoy it while you can, because we know the man is 39 years old. We see that there's some nights where he doesn't have it. There's some nights where he does. Boy, tonight, did he have it? The shot was working. He's shooting better than 40% from three now on the season. Did not shoot well from deep last season. Was in the low 30s last season. This season, better than 40% from three. He was on fire tonight. And every time the Nets wanted to make a run, every time. And the Lakers, let's face it, they tripped over their own 2 feet a number of times, kept turning the ball over. But every time the Nets tried to make a run, there was LeBron hitting another three. Hitting another three and another three. Every single time, LeBron was right there to answer, to keep the Nets at bay, and ultimately get the Lakers the win that they badly needed. Once again, the Lakers for the game shoot 57% from the field. The Nets, it's not like they shot poorly. 36% from three, 43% from the field's not great. But the Lakers, 17 turnovers. In fact, it was 10 or 11 in the third quarter alone, and that was where things started to get a little bit close, but LeBron James, again, was right there to slam the door shut on the Brooklyn Nets. Again, final score was 111-93. The Lakers get the win. All right, let me get into some of your questions and comments here. Andrew said, anyone else really liked what Gabe showed, especially on defense? Moved really well, too. Bron is insane. Our bench was just sad tonight, though. Yeah, just 2 points. 2 points for the game for the Lakers bench. Gabe Vincent was 1-for-4 shooting, 0-for-2 for Dinwiddie in 21 minutes, 0-for-1 from Colin Castleton, 0-for-2 for Torian Prince, who took a tough shot to the ribs. Hopefully he's okay. But yeah, Lakers bench, 1-for-9 shooting, 2 points, no free throws, nothing. Yeesh, not great, not great. But let's talk a little bit about Gabe Vincent. So Gabe Vincent returns his first game back it's almost like it's his first game of the season. Like he played in a couple of games, or I guess four games early on in the season. Then he picked up, I believe it was his fifth game. This was late in December, and instantly the knee was not a go. And so he winds up getting surgery on his knee. I really do look at it like this is kind of his first game of the season. He was so bad when he played before. You could see his knee wasn't quite right. And now he comes back, he's healthy. And there was some good and bad, which is to be expected from Gabe Vincent. Overall, I thought in the first half, I was pretty impressed with Gabe. I thought he did a really nice job defensively. I thought there were a number of times, there was a possession in particular where Mikal Bridges got him into the post and you went, uh-oh, Gabe Vincent's not that big. Mikal Bridges gets him into the post. This is going to be bad. Gabe held his ground really, really well and made Bridges settle for a turnaround jump shot that missed. It was a really nice defensive possession. I thought he was feisty. I thought he did what you needed him to do on the defensive side of the ball. He had a nice lob pass. I believe it was to AD. He was pretty good. Now, at the end of the third quarter, he had two back-to-back really bad mistakes. He sagged off of Cam Thomas. Everybody in the world could see Cam Thomas was wanting to step into a 2-for-1 3. There was like 30 seconds left in the quarter. And rather than push up and not allow Cam Thomas to get that three off, he sagged back, gave him the three, then closed the space and actually fouled him and gave Cam Thomas a 4-point play. And then Vincent immediately followed that up with a turnover on the offensive end. So that was a rough, 10 seconds of play there from Gabe Vincent. But big picture overall, I thought it was a pretty solid performance and a good bounce back from him, or a good return for him. And happy to see him back in there. Now, again, we've talked a lot about what happens to the rotation when Gabe Vincent is back. And maybe this is a little bit different because you had no Jackson Hayes in this game. Jackson Hayes did not play, was not available due to a calf contusion. So maybe things are a little bit skewed due to that. But we saw Gabe Vincent come in, get 14 minutes. Cam Reddish only got minutes in garbage time. That was it. Garbage time minutes for Cam Reddish, and that was all. He got a total of 2 minutes in this game. So had the game not been a blowout, Cam Reddish probably doesn't see minutes. So there's your answer right there. What's going to happen to the rotation? We talked about Max Christie would probably lose the limited minutes that he got. That is indeed what happened. He only played in three this game, and it was only in garbage time. And that Cam Reddish would probably lose his minutes as well. Again, that's exactly what happened. So that's where Gabe Vincent's minutes are going to be coming from Cam Reddish, from Max Christie. Their role, I think, is essentially gone in the rotation for right now. As long as everybody is healthy, we'll see how Torian Prince's ribs are doing. But assuming everybody else is healthy from here, it does appear until Jared Vanderbilt returns. Hopefully that's soon. He was actually out shooting before the game, so maybe that's a good sign. But until Vando returns, it looks like Gabe Vincent is taking Max Christie and Cam Reddish's role, and hopefully he can give the Lakers something. Remember, he's a guy who they spent their mid-level exception on, or most of it anyway. And if he can provide something for this team, that would be really big, potentially heading into the playoffs. Again, though, first game back, overall, pretty happy with what Gabe Vincent did out there. Tina, with an interesting comment. Whoops, wrong one there. It was an early master lock on Dylan Brooks. Tina said Gabe and Spencer shouldn't play together. I agree with that, Tina. I think that what we should be seeing is a lot of Gabe, and in fact, in terms of familiarity, I think it would make sense, D'Lo and Dinwiddie together a lot, and Reeves and Gabe together a lot. I think that would make some sense to allow the synergy between D'Angelo Russell and Spencer Dinwiddie from their time playing together already, ironically, in Brooklyn, to really allow those two to thrive together. And of course, you're going to get some D'Lo and Austin minutes, but Dinwiddie and Gabe together, while they give you a little bit defensively, they're not near the offensive threats that Reeves and D'Lo are. So I agree with you on that. I'd want that offensive punch out there and use Gabe, Dinwiddie as a method to add a defensive player in the backcourt next to Reeves or next to D'Lo, but not necessarily next to each other. All right, let's see what else we've got here. Aqua, two bench points. I understand the goal isn't to play Spencer Ball, but he isn't a spot-up shooter. Let him create for the second unit. What was the point of signing him? I don't mind him as a secondary creator. I don't mind him. If Reeves is on the floor, if D'Lo's on the floor, I don't mind Spencer Dinwiddie as a secondary creator at all. I think he's just fine in that role, and I would like to see him utilized more there. I wonder how much of this was Gabe Vincent was back. Things were kind of thrown off with that. But yes, in games recently, we've seen a little bit more of Dinwiddie getting to create, getting to produce a bit. Didn't really happen in this one. And a bit unfortunate because, you know, we focus on, well, is this a Dennis Schroeder revenge game playing against his former team, the Lakers? It was also a Spencer Dinwiddie revenge game. Remember, the Nets are the team that traded Dinwiddie to Toronto. And then they waived him. He became a Laker. Which, by the way, he said that recently, Dinwiddie said he 1,000% wants to stay with the Lakers this summer. I mean, sure. Sure. If he's willing to take a minimum to do it, I don't know if he is. Maybe there's a bigger offer out there. But if he is, I'd have no problem with that. We have a problem with Dinwiddie coming back. You could do a lot worse than Spencer Dinwiddie if we're talking about a bench rotation guard. Yeah. Why not? Why not? The two bench points thing, though, beyond just Dinwiddie, perhaps being an issue with Dinwiddie, that's also, I think, where Jared Vanderbilt potentially returning helps, right? Vanderbilt returning, if he can get to 100%, again, he was out basically shooting flat-footed jumpers before the game. I should say flat-footed set shots before the game. I don't know how soon he's going to be coming back. We're hoping sometime in early April, but hey, we're there. Tomorrow is April, right? So I don't know how quickly he's going to be back just yet. I hope he's back before the end of the season. But if Rui, and it doesn't necessarily even mean you have to bench Rui, but if Rui can share some more minutes with the Lakers bench, that goes a long way and perhaps even just solves your scoring problem off the bench. I mean, tonight Rui was fantastic. 20 points, 10 boards, 4 assists, 1 block, 8 of 12 shooting, 1 of 4 from 3. Rui had an excellent performance here in this game, and he gives you that instant scoring with the bench unit that right now does seem to be lacking. You know, again, is Torian going to score 0 points and hurt his ribs most nights? No, he's going to give you a few points. So is Spencer Dinwiddie going to give you 0 points most nights? No. Again, he only took 2 shots in this game. So that's not going to be typical. But still, I think it's fair to say over the last few weeks, the Lakers bench has needed a little bit of a scoring boost. And so when Vando gets back into the mix, even if it's not to start Jared Vanderbilt, even if he's at 80% of Vando, if he can just give you another player in the rotation that can shift a few of Rui's minutes to where he's on the floor with the bench group, I think that might help to mitigate, as we saw late in the game, it might help to mitigate this problem. We saw it in garbage time. Rui was still out there. And Cam Reddish was out there, and Max Christie missed a couple of shots, and that kind of stuff was happening. Max Lewis missed a shot, and then, oh, we need a bucket. Okay, they didn't need is a strong word there. It was just, hey, we'd like to score one here. Here, give the ball to Rui. Okay, pull-up jumper. Boom. That's it, right? So shifting some of Rui's minutes so that he can play more time alongside the bench might help to solve that bench scoring problem, which I think has been something that we've seen now over the last few weeks. All right, speaking of Rui, this is another one. And chat, you guys can let me know if I'm wrong, but I think this is pretty easy when we talk about the star in your role. So fire it off. Who's the star in your role from this game?
Star in your role.
Star in your role on this Easter Sunday. Who is it? Star in your role. I've got people still saying LeBron. Yeah. It's as I'm seeing it. You chat, you guys get it. You know where we're going with this. You know where we're going with this. It's Rui. There's no question. Look at this. We're all on the same page here. We're on the same page. Everybody knows. It's Rui Hachimura. Rui is the star in your role from this game. And look, there were other guys who had solid performances as well. But Rui Hachimura, again, you know, you look at D'Lo, 18 points, 6 assists, 4 steals. He was 4 for 11 from 3, which is not ideal for him. But it's not like he had a bad performance. Austin, 12, 7, and 6. By the way, Austin's rebounding. Something that's really improved lately. The last few games is rebounding. It's gotten much, much better. But 0 for 4 from 3 from Austin Reeves. So really, unless you want to give it to AD, which I always kind of de facto, you know, eliminate AD from the discussion. And AD was great in this game. Make no mistake. 24 points. We should talk more about him. 24 points, 14 boards, 3 blocks, 9 of 12 shooting, Andy hit a three. And he'll talk about that in a minute, that three-pointer. But Rui, I don't like going star in your role for a guy like AD, because he's, you know, the expectations are just higher from him. And his paycheck is higher as well. It tells you that the expectations are higher for him. So Rui Hachimura, 20 points, 10 boards, 4 assists, 8 of 12 shooting. He was great making those backdoor cuts. And I love the way the Lakers, they have been able to capitalize, putting Rui along the baseline. Teams continue to try or sometimes get switched into this situation where they put a small on Rui and think they can get away with it. And the Lakers go, oh, what? Oh, you put a dude who's 6'3 on Rui? He's 6'8 with a 7'2 wingspan. Here you go, Rui. And they give him the ball and they let him go to work. And it's great. Rui does a nice job there. A lot of times he cuts along the baseline too and will get finishes there. There's moments where Rui will make some mistakes and things like that. He blew a fast break by just fumbling the basketball. But for the most part, Rui has really thrived in that role, kind of along the baseline there, taking the corner three when it's open, and otherwise waiting for everybody to fall asleep because they're watching LeBron do LeBron things or AD do AD things. And then Rui just sneaks along, makes a cut, and gets a dunk. And he's done a nice job of that. So Rui Hachimura, I thought, was excellent in this game. I also love that he's the kind of guy that teams will cheat off of him, and he can make them pay consistently. That's what I talk about a lot. It's important that you punish teams for their choices. You have to make them pay for the choices that they make. If you're going to double AD, okay. But then we're going to move the ball, and the guy who it winds up with, whether it's Austin, whether it's D'Lo, whether it's Rui, whoever it is, we're going to trust that that guy's going to knock down the open shot that you're creating by sending a double at AD. We're going to counter that. Rui has the ability to make teams pay for leaving him. We've seen it against Memphis. We saw it a few days ago. We saw it in the playoffs this last year. And he's got bailout ability, meaning if the shot clock's winding down, you don't have to throw the ball to LeBron or AD. You can give it to Rui, and against just about anybody, at the very least, he can get his 15-foot jumper, which he makes at a decent enough clip. So I think Rui's done a really nice job overall this season, and I really like what we've seen out of him recently. He's been good in the starting lineup. I think Jared Vanderbilt coming back allows you to even to expand Rui's role in the way that he can lift up the scoring of that bench unit as well. All right. Let's see what we've got here. I'm seeing a lot of the chat comments coming in here. Jared said, crazy what happens when you go into a game focused and take the first quarter seriously. Great win. Yeah, the Lakers led, 17-0, I believe, at one point in the first quarter. Yeah, that's nice. Now, I can say the Lakers' defense was focused. Some of that, we have to admit, was the Nets just missing shots. And there was regression that eventually hit. They started draining shots in the second quarter. They were red hot. Then they hit them again in the third. But the Lakers did come out focused, and they capitalized on the Nets missing those shots. And they went into attack mode. Now you could feel the Lakers, their energy, their intensity, their focus, whatever you want to call it, wane a little bit through certain stretches of the game, which is normal. That will happen. But nonetheless, the Lakers looked like they came out bothered by losing to the Pacers and said, we need to bounce back from that. And that's exactly what they did. They came back, they bounced back against the Nets in this one. And they were, again, fantastic. I want to take a quick peek here at the scoreboard right now around the NBA. The Thunder are right now down with 4 minutes to play in the third, down 8. I kind of want the Thunder to win there because you want Denver to be stuck in the third seed. Denver got a blowout win over the Cavs earlier today, which again was not ideal. I know there's the whole Nick Wright theory out there that no, the Lakers want the Nuggets in round one. They want to see them while they're at their healthiest and all that kind of stuff. I'm not of that mindset. I don't want to see the Nuggets until the West Finals, and I prefer that somebody else knocks them off on the way there because I don't like the matchup. And I think by waiting, not only that, even if you're the gung-ho, I don't care, we can beat the Nuggets, you know, we're going to do that, that's fine. I think waiting till later just allows Jared Vanderbilt to get that much healthier and maybe into the mix there. So I would prefer to wait to see the Nuggets. Right now, the Warriors are beating. So I want the Nuggets down in the three seed, two seed. I don't want them in the one seed where the Lakers are more likely, if they get through the play-in, to see them in round one. And again, if you disagree, more power to you. That's fine. But Warriors up right now 7 on the Spurs at the end of the third quarter with 40 seconds to play in the third. Would like to see the Spurs win that game. Might be tough, but would obviously be ideal if they won that game. The Wolves down 4 to the Bulls. I'd prefer to see the Wolves win that game. Do it once again, push Denver down, but that's me. The Mavs blowing out the Rockets up 20 with 11:30 to play. You can make an argument either way on that one. Like the Rockets losing, I guess, it limits the floor for the Lakers of the Rockets, you know, moving up. And if the Lakers were to go on a losing streak or something, but the Mavs losing would have pushed them maybe down a little. They've been winning. I don't think the Lakers are going to reach the Mavs anyway, but nonetheless, that's not the, there's good and bad that comes with that outcome. So taking a quick peek at the standings, and I'll show you guys what I'm looking at here. The Lakers right now, surprise, surprise, right? They're still in the 9 seed. Lakers still sitting in the 9 seed right now, and they've been stuck there for a long time. And the reason for that is because the rest of the West keeps winning. So take a look at this. If you're with me on YouTube, on X, on Facebook, you guys can see what I'm talking about. Podcast listeners, just trust me as I'm walking you through this. The Lakers right now, one game up or one game back of the Sacramento Kings, a game and a half back of the Phoenix Suns. Remember, Sacramento has the tiebreaker over the Lakers. The Lakers 2 games up on the Warriors, but remember, the Lakers do play the Warriors again before the season ends. And once again, the Warriors in action right now against the Spurs. So that cushion right there could be cut. The Warriors have won 3 in a row. That's not ideal. You'd like to see the Warriors drop some games here. Now, the key is going to be the Phoenix Suns. They just lost to the Thunder the other night. They've got to keep dropping games because you've got the tiebreaker over them. It's almost like you have an extra game advantage there because you have the tiebreaker. You can finish tied with Phoenix and be okay. You're a game and a half back of them right now. The Lakers are very much in pursuit here, but now they've got, coming up, you've got Toronto and then second night of a back-to-back, Washington. Both bad teams, both tanking teams. You should win both those games, but a back-to-back on the road, particularly you've got the trap game of it being the last game of a road trip, you never know what's going to happen there. Then you've got some more difficult games. You've got a back-to-back with Cleveland and Minnesota. Those two teams, back-to-back, is going to be tough. So right now, the biggest key for the Lakers to move up, you're rooting for Kings losses and Suns losses. And then in order to maintain your floor at the 9 seed, it's Warriors losses. Those are the 3 most important things right now for the Lakers in terms of what other teams do. It's the Suns losing, the Kings losing, the Warriors losing. Again, I would like to see the Denver Nuggets stick in that 3 seed and not move up to 1. So that would be another thing. But right now, we can really only focus on what the Lakers are doing. The most important thing, Suns lose, Kings lose, Warriors lose, Lakers win. And of course, those things all don't matter much unless the Lakers have to win, take care of business on their own, and then hope some other things happen there. All right, let's go here. Is Playoff Rui a thing, and is he back? So is Playoff Rui a thing? Yes. Yeah, Playoff Rui is a thing. He is, as I recall, as crazy as this sounds, Rui Hachimura is the NBA's leader in three-point percentage in the playoffs. And I'm not talking about like last season. I'm talking about all time. Rui is the all-time three-point percentage leader. Now, it's a smaller sample size than some other guys, of course. So there's, you know, plenty of context there to get into, but he is a positive playoff performer. That's what we've seen. Is Playoff Rui here? Well, let's take a peek at what he's been doing in the month of March. Since we're right here at the end of March, let's see how Rui's month has looked. And I can tell you, as I'm pulling it up, I know it's been really good. All right, Rui, for the month of March, Rui Hachimura, 59% from the field. Oh, 49% from 3. 4.5 rebounds. You'd like that to go up, but guess what? 3 of his last 4 games, he's had double-digit rebounds. 3 of his last 4. Now, the one that he didn't, he had 0 rebounds, so that's not ideal. But 3 of his last 4, Rui has had double-digit rebounds, and that was his first time all season touching double-digit rebounds. So think about that. So perhaps there's a mindset change there. If he's done it 3 times in his last 4 games and didn't do it at all for throughout the rest of the season, we've talked about how Rui needed to become more of a factor on the boards. Maybe there has been a bit of a shift there with Rui Hachimura. It could just be coincidence, but the fact that he's done it three times now in four games when he never did it before this season, I think there's probably something to that. So he's been great there, and he's improved over the last few games, plus 17 points in total from Rui Hachimura. He's been excellent. And if Rui is activating playoff mode, I just hope it continues through the playoffs. He's been really good. And you know what else? All those teams who, when the Lakers were talking to them at the trade deadline, saying, well, I don't know. Rui, maybe he's neutral value, maybe negative. He's got two more years left on his deal. We don't want that. Two more years on his contract. That could be a bad contract right there. Yeah, the Lakers, I think, hung up the phone on those teams, and rightfully so. Like, we know what Rui is. We know he's probably a value on his contract right now. He's certainly not overpaid on his deal. And I think we're seeing that right now. Can we trade for Mikal Bridges? So yeah, salary is not too high, but the problem is I don't think the Nets want to move him. I mean, they've reportedly turned down what was a big offer from the Rockets at the trade deadline that would have included some of their picks. Now, we don't know if there were protections on those or what that would have looked like, plus Jalen Green for Bridges. And Jalen Green's been going nuts. So that doesn't look great. That tells you how highly the Nets value Bridges. Now, I don't necessarily think that's the right decision. I don't think that's the right decision for them, because Bridges is 27. He's going to be 28 next season. By the time they truly rebuild this roster, and who knows what's going to happen to Nick Claxton this summer when he hits free agency, but Mikal Bridges is not a 1A guy. I think he would look great next to LeBron and AD. I think he'd be great there. But the Nets apparently want to build around him as though he's a 1A guy, like he is the build a cornerstone for their future. I don't agree with that. If I'm the Nets and the Rockets called me up and said, hey, Jalen Green, plus your picks back, all of them, draft day style, Kevin Costner, I want my picks back, all of them, and David Putney because I feel like it. If that's the case, if I'm the Nets, I would have said yes. And yeah, let's do this. Let's do that. Let's get our picks back, and let's really do this the right way. Now, again, it's possible the Rockets may have said, hey, we'll give you your picks back, but they're all lottery protected or something. I don't know. I don't know what that looked like. So there's a lot of nuance to this that's important. But if the Nets aren't entertaining that, Jalen Green plus picks that happen to originally belong to the Nets, which matters a lot when you're going into a rebuild, they're not considering moving Bridges for that, I tend to buy that they're just not moving him. Now, if they do put him on the market, yeah, I think the Lakers will have interest. What will the price be? We'll see. And I'll tell you what, Nets fans are probably going to lose their minds if it's less than the rumored offer that everybody's heard about now with Jalen Green and their own picks back. Yikes. But if they can get him, he'd be a great fit. He'd be a great fit with LeBron and AD. All right, Koa said, I was going to cuss the hell out of this team, but my goat helped forget about that disgraceful third. Wanted him to hit 10 threes so bad. Bron going off in Brooklyn never gets old. Love the crowd there when he plays. Yeah, let's give credit, right? The Brooklyn crowd gave LeBron a standing ovation, which was fantastic to see. Give them a lot of credit for that. LeBron put on an incredible performance. There's no denying that. Carlos said the Nets don't have fans. Maybe that's why. Is it kind of like the Clippers? Where like, Nets fans, like everybody in New York is a Knicks fan. Like people come to see the opposing team for the Nets. It's a little bit of that dynamic where like there aren't real Clipper fans out there. Anyway, my theory anyway is that Clippers fans don't actually exist. You've got Lakers haters who just are LA transplants and they've hated the Lakers all their lives, so they can't root for the Lakers, so they join up with the Clippers. Or you've got people who live elsewhere and we'll cheer for the Clippers as a way to kind of stick it through the Lakers. It's more Laker hate than actual Clipper fandom. And I'm in part kidding. I know there are some actual Clippers fans out there, but I do think they're the kind of team where there's a lot of fans who are like fans of other teams, but also will support the Clippers just to kind of stick it to the Lakers a little bit. I think there's a lot of that more than I'm a diehard Clipper fan, right? You're about likely to find to actually run into the Easter Bunny as you are to find a diehard Clipper fan. I think the same kind of holds true for the Nets, where they're the second team. People are diehard Knicks fans. You don't get that quite as much though with the Nets, where you have diehard Nets fans. But I think they do. I don't think it's quite as bad as it is with the Clippers and with the Lakers. I don't think the effect is quite the same. I think there are Nets fans out there for sure. They've had more success historically than the Clippers have. They made it to the finals against the Lakers in 02. They've got some history there. So I'm not saying there's no Nets fans, but they are that second team in there. So I do wonder how much of that effect is a team like the Lakers comes in and you've got a lot of Lakers fans in the building. When we're talking about LeBron getting the standing ovation, how many Lakers fans are in the building compared to like true diehard Nets fans? You know what I'm saying? All right. Always got to take a shot at the Clippers when I can. Glad you guys enjoyed that in the chat. Campbell said, I understand Gabe Vincent being hesitant to shoot, but there's no excuse for Spencer and Prince being so scared to shoot the three ball. We've seen this a few times recently where the Lakers have looked a little hesitant to take the three, a little hesitant to pull the trigger when they need to. And that's not ideal, right? You want guys in rhythm to take the shot. We've actually seen a few turnovers in the last week and a half, a few times where the team has turned the ball over by overpassing. And that's not, that mindset isn't necessarily a bad thing. You just have to manage it, right? And it's move the ball, but within reason. When the open shot is there, you've got to take it, and you've got to take it with confidence. And that's true of Torian Prince, who again was dealing with a rib injury, got hit pretty hard there, was down for a little bit. Hopefully he's okay, fingers crossed. And then Spencer Dinwiddie, I was surprised we didn't get a more aggressive Dinwiddie, given that he was back in Brooklyn. I mean, when Spencer was with the Nets and played the Lakers, he dropped 19. Now going back to Brooklyn, he dropped 0. I was a little surprised by that. I thought we were going to see kind of a revenge game Spencer Dinwiddie in this one. But we didn't. As far as Gabe Vincent being hesitant to shoot, it really felt like Gabe wanted to get a few shots up early, wanted to get a bucket and kind of get that out of the way, and then just kind of let the game come to him. So he took some early shots and things. He looks like he's a little bit uncertain of when to shoot or whatever, but that's all 100% to be expected. Completely to be expected with Gabe Vincent. Not surprised at all that he looked, you know, a little off rhythm. It would be a shock if he didn't look off rhythm. They're just coming back. So again, that's not being critical of Gabe. That's to be expected that he would look that way. All right, let's get to this one. Kaleidoscope said, truly glad to witness a once-in-a-lifetime player. Master lock turnovers and fouls on threes. Yeah, the turnovers were pretty bad for the Lakers in this one. The three-point fouls were not good. There were some rough moments. There were some rough moments for sure. And there were some moments where it felt like their attention to detail waned a little bit, which, again, that could be expected when you get up by a big lead. It's hard mentally to stay locked in all that for that long, but they still won wire to wire, right? So was there stuff that we could complain about in this game? Sure, but it was a wire to wire win. So we'll take it. We'll take it. And a lot of that was thank you for LeBron. Julian on X, that just tells me you missed the beginning of the show, man. If you think we're not talking enough about LeBron, you missed the beginning of the show. We've talked all about how amazing LeBron was in this game. Besides LeBron making shots in the fourth, we played god-awful second half. I keep saying fundamentals, IQ, carelessness will cost us in the long run. We're so bad in the other areas that matter to winning long-term. I would hope, anyway, that if the game was closer, we wouldn't have seen such a letdown from the Lakers in terms of the focus, the energy, the intensity, all of those things. I would hope, again, that if the game was closer, we wouldn't have seen that. The Lakers were running away with it, and you're just kind of naturally, it's hard to keep up that pace, that intensity, the entire game. So I think they were kind of a victim of their own success a little bit in this game. But you're right. If you do that against a better team, you're probably going to get caught. If LeBron doesn't go nuts from three, maybe you get caught, and then you've got a really bad loss on your hands. So I understand the concern, given how far up the Lakers were. And yes, LeBron bailed them out a little bit, but it's no certainty that even if LeBron isn't going crazy from three, that they don't still come away with the win. Maybe it's not quite as comfortable of a win, but I understand they, you know, they didn't dominate the entire game. They dominated the first half. There were some moments in the second quarter they didn't. The third quarter was the Nets quarter. They won the third by a lot. I think they won the third by 12. And then there were some shaky moments in the fourth. But ultimately, the Lakers walked away with the win. They never trailed. And the Nets, I think they got it down to 7 or 8 at one point, and that was as close as it was. So I don't know. I can't be too mad at the Lakers, even though we did see them, no question, take their foot off the gas pedal. All right, guys, let's give a quick shout out to our sponsor, and that is Sleeper. You guys know if you play along with us, you can get out your Sleeper app. Super easy to find, easy to download. You can use the QR code that's on the screen. Let's make some picks here. I also have the link in the description. Use our code Lakers Nation. You get up to a $500 deposit match, which is a fantastic deal that they offer. De'Aaron Fox, 6.5 assists against Utah. I'm going more on that. Malik Monk is out. He's done. He has a sprained MCL, and he's going to be out 4 to 6 weeks, which means we're probably talking through round one of the playoffs. So terrible timing for the Kings. That's going to mean a much bigger burden on De'Aaron Fox, and I think it's going to mean the ball in his hands that much more. So I think he does hit more on those assists. So we'll grab that one. And once again, chat, you guys can play along with me. Let's see here. Let's go to... Well, we've got a lot from the Jazz Kings game. DeAndre Ayton has been getting some double doubles recently. I don't know if I want to go with him though. Let's take a look at Jaren Jackson Jr. Jaren Jackson Jr. going up against Detroit, 21 points. He's going against Jalen Duren. I kind of like the 31.5 points, rebounds, and assists for Jaren Jackson a little bit more. Now, he did not do that recently against Orlando. I've got a good feeling against Detroit with Jaren Jackson. I'm going to go more on that one. I'll take that one. I'm going to go more, even though he's only cleared that once in his last four. I think against Detroit, he can get that done. I think Memphis is going to be feisty enough to pull that one off. And then last one we'll do. Oh, let's go. Harrison Barnes on threes. Harrison Barnes hasn't hit 2 threes in a game in a while. I'm going to go less than 2 threes or less than 1.5 threes for Harrison Barnes. So a $20 entry would be a $132 win if we get this one right. 6.6x multiplier. De'Aaron Fox, Jaren Jackson Jr., and Harrison Barnes on this one. Once again, no Malik Monk now. That's a big deal. You know, I was talking earlier about the standings and how the Lakers need the Kings to lose games. Like, I don't want it to happen this way. I'll be honest. Look, it'll be great if the Lakers pass the Kings. I never want to see it happen because the guy's hurt, though. And this is a big, big blow to the Kings, especially a former Laker like Malik Monk. You never want to see that, but sprained MCL, he's going to be out. He was a big part of that Kings team, and they lost Kevin Huerter. Season-ending shoulder surgery. So the Kings lose two very key pieces for them. And they do have still a difficult schedule ahead. So we'll see. I think it's very possible for the Lakers to catch them. But, man, heal up quick, Malik Monk. Just never want to see stuff like that happen. Checking in on some of the scores real quick. Wolves now up 1 on the Bulls with 4:40 to play there. The Spurs within 8 now of the Warriors. But 7 minutes to play there in the game. The Thunder down 3 to the Knicks with 10:42 to play there. That could, if those results hold, the Thunder losing and the Wolves now only up 1. If the Wolves, this will put the Wolves, I believe, into the 1 seed, depending on how their tiebreaker with Denver looks. this would keep the Wolves in the one seed and move the Thunder down to the three seed if the Thunder dropped this game indeed to the Knicks. Again, right now they're down three, but still plenty of time to play in the fourth quarter. So again, just kind of keeping an eye on all this. The Jazz and the Kings do play tonight. The Kings, a very heavy favorite. No Lauri Markkanen for Utah. So it's a 12.5 point edge for Sacramento. That's massive, but you never know with these things. You just never know. The Lakers were a 16.5 point underdog against Boston without LeBron and AD, and they won. So you never know, but the Kings fairly likely to pick up a win tonight. Okay, let's get a little further into some of your questions and comments. We do need to get to the master lock of the night in just a moment. Let's see. And I got out of order here. There it is. All right. Everyone says the reason we need Vando is his defense, but we also needed Rui as the scoring punch off the bench. 2 points at the half is not good. Yes, agree 100%. That's something I've been talking about. Rui, you could probably use him mixed in with that bench unit to give him that scoring. Get rid of Prince and Spencer this offseason. Okay, so Spencer Dinwiddie has said he wants to come back to the Lakers. I wouldn't have a problem with that if it's on a veteran minimum deal, and I think the Lakers may only have veteran minimums, depending on what happens with D'Lo. We'll see. We'll see what happens in free agency with D'Angelo Russell, but I wouldn't have a problem with Spencer Dinwiddie coming back. I think he's fine, and I wouldn't be surprised if he took that minimum to come back with the Lakers. I think he likes playing in L.A. As far as Prince goes, I think he would like to stay with the Lakers. Ideally, he's on a biannual exception right now. The Lakers could give him a little raise off of that if he's willing to take that. But yeah, we'll see what happens with Torian Prince. As long as you're not asking Torian to play starters minutes and be the team's primary point of attack wing defender, he's just fine. He's playing 15 to 20 minutes a night. Let him knock in some threes every now and then. And occasionally he can drive to the basket and get you something there. Every once in a while, he will flash some passing ability when he gets into the paint. And there's nothing wrong with that. At $4.5 million, no problem whatsoever. The problem with Torian comes when you put him into a role that's bigger and say, play 31 minutes a night and be our perimeter defender and all these things. That's where you get yourself into trouble. No problem with Torian, as long as he's within that role. Jose Calderon. Welcome in, Jose. Former Laker. Nice win. I know I'm late, but I can't believe they misspelled my name on Kobe's statue. That's a pretty good one. I know, Jose. I can't either. Joseph said, bah, the goat noise. I guess it's more of a sheep noise when I do it. LeBron decided to just be Steph Curry today. Also, despite the shooting, I didn't mind what I saw from Gabe Vincent. Great screen navigation. Yes, good point out on the screen navigation and unselfish plays. Hope he finds his rhythm soon. Yeah, the key with Gabe, it's going to be just patience. It's going to take time. And I know right now, patience is in very short supply. We don't have a lot of patience because the Lakers have to win games right now because they're in a big playoff race and they need to move up to the 7 or 8. So they're in double elimination territory in the play-in and all of that. Every game matters so much. You don't have time for patience. But the reality is with Gabe, it's going to require patience because he's not at 100%. It's going to take time for him to figure it out. It's going to. But remember, this is the guy the Lakers spent almost all of their mid-level exception on. Their one player that they could spend more on that wasn't a returning player was Gabe Vincent. And there's a reason for that. And so the Lakers are hoping that if they are patient, if they give him his time here, by the time the playoffs start up, which is just a couple of weeks away now, because here we are, that will pay dividends. That he will be able to get back into that rhythm, and he'll be a solid player for the Lakers. Here we go. And Choco Thunder said, let Gabe sit the first of a back-to-back. Don't push the knee. Yeah, I don't disagree with that. I think that may be, if it's not the Lakers' plan, it probably should be their plan. I think that what they need is they need to make sure that Gabe Vincent stays healthy and they don't rush him. LeBron talked about it last game, that you don't want to put too much on him too soon. And so if that means not playing in a back-to-back, great. Great. All right, everybody. Let's do it. Let's get into our favorite segment. The Master Lock of the Night. Let's go.
Master Lock of the Night.
Master Lock of the Night. Chat, let me know. What was the most annoying thing from this game? What bothered you the most? Plop says Dylan Brooks. As always, Master Lock Dylan Brooks. Yes, indeed. The bench. Bench scoring, I'm seeing. The backcourt minus Gabe Vincent. I'm seeing Master Lock turnovers. Turnovers in the bench. I believe turnovers were my Master Lock against the Pacers. Master Lock bench. Master Lock Cam Thomas. Turnovers. Oh, this is probably fair. Master Lock my... See, like, I can even... You know how sometimes you think it sounds better than it actually does? Right? Like when you're singing in the shower or something like that. You think it sounds better than it really does. Then other people have to tell you. No, there's none of that here. I have no illusion thinking that my goat sound effect is good in any way. Like, it sounds terrible even in my head. So I can only imagine what you guys are hearing. And I apologize for you guys having to hear it. All right. Master Lock the third quarter. Fouling three-point shooters. All things that are worthy of Master Locks for sure. Three-guard lineup, I see. The Nets mini comeback. Yeah. All things that are worth being Master Locked. Oh, somebody's watching the Dodger game. Master Lock Joe Kelly. Master Lock Lonnie Walker being a bench warmer in Brooklyn, right? Can we get some run here, Lonnie Walker? Oh, this is... Somebody said my goat noise is actually good. All right. I'll take that. Passing on open shots. Another one said, I've got a great goat noise. Okay. All right. I will say, hey, I appreciate it. Just increasing my confidence. Thank you. All right. Here's what I'm going to do, though. My official Master Lock of the Night. It's Cam Thomas. Cam Thomas, you're a good player. You're a good scorer. But why do you have to go and do this kind of stuff whenever you play the Lakers? And I know it's not just the Lakers. He had a good month. But still, why do you got to do this stuff? Hit these crazy sidestep threes. Go in these scoring binges. Jump like 10 feet in the air on your jump shots. I don't know how he does that. See how high he gets on his jumper? It's unreal. Master Lock Cam Thomas for going berserk against the Lakers on a consistent... This is now twice. We see the Nets twice in the season. Both times, Cam Thomas went nuts. Both times. Now, in the month of March, he's averaging 26.5 points, so it's not like he's that far below his average. It's going to be interesting to see what the Nets do with Cam Thomas this summer. But still, Cam... Do we really have to shoot 57% from three against the Lakers? Do we really have to get a month-long high 12 free throw attempts in this one? That was one of my keys to the game, not having a Cam Thomas blow-up scoring game. And that's exactly what the Nets got. Now, again, he's scoring even more than I thought when I looked at the month of March. 30 this game, 28 the game before, 38 the game before that. 19, 21, 25, 31. So it's pretty normal for him to hit these numbers. But yeah, could have done without some of those crazy Cam Thomas threes late in the game when he was trying to will that team back into it. Could have done without that. No, thank you, Cam Thomas. Going to give him the Master Lock. Maybe next time he won't do that. He does have a team option for next year. At $4 million. Have to believe the Nets will pick that up. Let me double check. Cam Thomas. Yeah, team option, but he's extension eligible this summer. be interesting to see what the Nets do there with him. He's been really good. All right, everybody. Thank you guys for joining. Once again, the Lakers do pick up the win. Stick around. Don't go anywhere, though. Sean Davis's post-game show is starting up in just a moment. But I want to thank all of you. Of course, come join us over on Playback during the games. Hang out with us. It's a lot of fun. Playback.tv/LakersNation or right here on the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. If you've not done so yet, please hit that subscribe button. Subscribe to the channel as well as that like button as well. All right. Thank you again, everybody. Super chats that I didn't get to, I will put on the next show. So TikTok Exposed saying, I missed your super chat. I'm saving them all right now, and I will put them on the show that I'm recording tomorrow. So be on the lookout for that. I will still get to those. Don't worry. I will make sure I put those on the next show. All right, everybody. Thank you again. Till next time. See ya. And stay safe.